Good morning. So it's interesting having our office in the south in Atlanta because they all reckon they have southern accents. I tell them I'm from the real deep south, Australia. But this morning, just in this Sunday school, I want to talk about just one of those questions that we get about our faith. And I'm sure some of you, when you've been sharing and talking with your friends and family members, and even your children coming home, as a result of public school education, they come home with questions like, well, Mum, Dad, how come I can't see dinosaurs mentioned in the Bible? You know, are they real? I've seen Christians go through all sorts of contortions, you know, maybe Satan created dinosaur fossils and put them in the rocks to confuse us and all sorts of stuff. Why is that? Well, it's because as soon as you hear the word dinosaurs, most of us hear information presented from the culture in a framework of millions of years. And the millions of years is a corollary to evolution. Evolution requires millions of years of time to allow for supposedly slow, gradual changes. You know, dinosaurs evolved into birds 65 million years ago. But I want to show you, and we're just going to deal with this subject, and you'll hear more in the main service, that if we start with a Bible-first approach, how we can actually answer these questions scientifically, and not going to be heavy, but just logically, how we deal with the issues. So I've got to look at a screen today. I normally have my laptop here, so just excuse me if I pause. Our website, and I'll mention a couple of things again in the main service when more people get here. Our website has now over 9,500 fully searchable articles on that site. If you looked up at the topics button there, when you click on that, a box drops down and they're in subject headings. Everything from ape men to geology, genealogies, all the way through to zoology, everything in between. That's about 35 years worth of creation research. And here's the point, it's all free. All free. We employ more scientists than any Christian ministry in the world, to the best of my knowledge anyway. And we're faith funded to put information into your hands. And when you came in and you saw those books, that's some of the information that we have. And why do we do that? Well, it's just mums and dads supporters all around the world to do that. But the reason is because people only get one source of information. They only get one answer. Like I said, you only hear about dinosaurs being presented in a framework of millions of years. So the only way you're going to teach your children, your grandchildren, to get information from a Christian or a biblical perspective is by going to resources like Creation Ministries International and the other good creation organizations in this country. There's the web address. Okay, pretty easy to remember that one, isn't it? So when you see some claims on TV and your children say, Mum, Dad, is that right? Is that true? Go to creation.com, we'll usually have an answer there within a couple of days. The Bible tells us to be ready to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that is in you. You get lots of questions, don't you, when you're sharing your faith. You know, you want to talk about the Lord Jesus and they come up with you and say, well, you know, tell me where the races came from. Like, for example, why is that? Well, again, understanding how the world thinks is a real prerequisite, I believe, if we're going to be effective in our evangelism. And I'm going to show you today that evolution is actually not about science. In fact, creation's not about science. They are both belief systems or philosophies or worldviews, if you like, that we make up to determine our place in the world. And what we do is we look at facts, we interpret facts in accordance with our belief system. You're going to see that as we go along. In this talk, I'm going to show you how you can interpret exactly the same facts that evolutionists see, but within a biblical framework. And Colossians 2:8 reminds us, look at this, see to it that no one takes you captive through hollow and deceptive philosophy which depends upon human tradition and the basic principles of this world rather than on Christ. I submit to you the theory of evolution is actually a mechanism to explain the world and the universe without God. How you and I got to be here without a creator. Understand that, okay? You'll see more, as I said, it's not about science. The evolutionary worldview says millions of years of death, suffering. You've heard of survival of the fittest, for example, ultimately led to mankind. And as I said, dinosaurs evolved to birds. And you see those people, how they're looking at the world. A worldview is like a filter, a framework through which you interpret your world. You're going to see that our worldview is vitally important into understanding how we think. So, for example, if I showed you that picture there, and you can see I've got a parrot, A, T-Rex, number B, a fish, C, and a dolphin, D. And if I was to ask you the question, let's do a little snap poll this morning. Indulge the little Aussie here, okay? Which one of these has been on earth the longest? Who thinks A? Anybody? Okay, who thinks B? Who thinks C? Who thinks D? That wasn't a very good response. Who's too chicken to say E? All of you. Okay. Well, see, I actually got a totally mixed range. Somebody answered at least one of those categories. But actually, biblically speaking, the answer would be, well, let's have a look. 6 days of creation. Let's work it out, starting with the Bible. Have a look at that. On day five, God made the sea and the flying creatures, which would mean A, C, and D. And guess what? The T-Rex, he's been on earth the shortest. But I noticed here, most of the children actually put their hands up and said, the T-Rex. Why? Dinosaurs lived millions of years ago. That's what we're told. See? And actually, all the land animals, sauropod dinosaurs, theropods, brachiosaurus, T-Rex, were made on day six along with man. Have a look. Genesis 1:25 tells us, God made the wild animals according to their kinds, the livestock according to their kinds, and all the creatures that move along the ground according to their kinds, and God saw that it was good. Is T-Rex a creature that moves along the ground? There you go. So see, if you start with the Bible, you can work these things out. Now, I want to look at some of these stereotypical ideas we get about dinosaurs portrayed in the media. The idea that they're always these ferocious meat eaters, okay? Have a look at this. This is a representation of a T-Rex tooth. A lot of people don't know they actually have serrated edges on them. Make pretty good steak knives, perhaps, wouldn't they? Now, have a look. Remember I said that evolutionists and creationists, we have the same facts. So here's a fact. I've got a skull. And let me tell you a little bit about the skull. Those fangs there, very, very sharp and pointy. You know, I look at those and I think, well, maybe they're used for grabbing hold of its prey, you know, piercing the flesh and locking it into place. And then once I do that, those teeth on the side there, they are so sharp that I could actually slice a piece of paper with them. That's how sharp they are. So maybe they get to work, you know, with some sawing action for sawing off lumps of flesh or something like that. So I've told you a couple of things about that skull, but does anybody here want to have a guess what you think that is a skull of? I gave you some information. Anybody want to have a guess? What do you think? Saber tooth. Anybody else? Gator? One more? Okay. See, now you all actually thought of creatures that typically tear meat apart. Why did I do that? Why did you do that? Well, I actually presented it to you within a framework. It's actually the skull of a fruit bat. See, so what I did, I conned you. I actually deceived you, okay, just to prove a point. All I had is a skull with sharp teeth, but I presented it to you within a framework and said maybe those teeth are used for piercing flesh and sawing it up. So I gave you a way of thinking about it. But that's actually not what you can tell just by looking at the skull. Sharp teeth are not a sign of what something eats. You actually have to see it eating or look at its stomach contents, etc. These fruit bats actually used to flap around in our papaya trees in our back garden in Brisbane, Australia. They make a big racket, I can tell you. But what does a fruit bat eat? Fruit. That's right. It has sharp teeth for eating fruit. If you think of something like panda bears in China, they have incredibly sharp teeth used for eating bamboo. Exactly. So have a look at this. This was a sign outside of the bear exhibit at Australia's most famous zoo, Taronga Zoo in Sydney. Now look what it says. And try to figure out where there's a mistake there. Although bears have teeth designed for eating meat, their diet consists mainly of plants. Is there something wrong with that statement? They say they have teeth designed for eating meat, but what do they actually see them eat? Plants. So it is a carnivore or a herbivore. It's a herbivore, isn't it? It's plants. But see, again, they look at the teeth and they say, oh, it must be a meat eater. No, sharp teeth are not a sign of what something eats. So, you know, T-Rex, maybe he was originally designed to eat cantaloupes or something like that. And in fact, I actually know that's the case. So if you read back in Scripture, it says, not only Adam and Eve, the first people, were given every herb and seed and fruit for food, it actually says the animals also. Now you're thinking, well, hang on, don't creatures have specialized diets, etc.? Well, yes, today that can be the case because over periods of time, creatures become specialized or adapted to their environment. That's not evolution, okay? Creatures only change within their limited kinds. But everything, including human beings and the animals, was originally created vegetarian. What happened? Well, there was a fall, wasn't there? Bad things entered the world as a result of sin. Now, Sir Richard Owen, this scientist, he's the guy that came up actually with the name dinosaur. That's why you don't see the word dinosaur in the Bible anywhere. It's a modern word. It wasn't invented until 1841. He found the bones of an iguanodon and a megalosaur, and he said these look like the bones of some fearsome lizard or terrible lizard. Dinosaur is actually Greek. It means fearsome lizard. So what's other modern words you might not see in the Bible? Computer, you know, laptop. Space shuttle. Exactly. So they're modern words that we make up. Now the problem with the idea that dinosaurs were roaming and roaming around for millions of years and tearing each other apart actually violates the gospel. Because clearly when I look at scripture on day six when God finished from his creation, it said it was very good. And sin and death entered the world as a result of what Adam and Eve did. So there was no death and bloodshed before Adam. You can't have animals and creatures tearing each other apart for millions of years before Adam and Eve. Look at this. This is from a secular website, discovery.com. They're looking at the scanning tumors on the rib cage of these sauropod dinosaurs. And see what it says? Screening of their vertebrae revealed that tumors in these prehistoric creatures, so they think, were exactly like the cancers we see today. So cancer hadn't evolved over millions of years. That's the first point. The second point is, were cancers around in dinosaurs for millions of years before Adam and Eve? Because cancer's not good, is it? Absolutely not. But God pronounced everything as being good on day six. What about the idea there are always these large, fearsome beasts? I mean, that's why we're fascinated with them, right? We have these huge, large creatures. But a lot of people don't know some of the dinosaurs were as small as a chicken. You need your teeth in to say this one, Compsognathus, okay? Just imagine, boys and girls, if he was still around today, you'd be in KFD instead of KFC. That'd be neat, wouldn't it? Think about that. But when we look at the fossils, and that's how we know about dinosaurs, it looks like the average size of the dinosaurs was probably, you know, about the size of a Great Dane, you know, a small pony, something like that. And it was only a very small percentage of the fossils that we find of the dinosaurs that grew to be those very, very large creatures, you know, Apatosaurus, Brachiosaurus, Diplodocus, etc. And all dinosaurs, even those great big ones, all started off from eggs. And the largest fossilized dinosaur eggs we've ever seen are only about the size of a football, something like that. So that 60-foot Apatosaurus, he started off from originally an egg-sized or a football-sized egg. So they were all actually once small. And as I said, fossils tell us that dinosaurs, yes, they really did exist. They're not a problem. They're just part of God's creation, part of his majesty in making these incredible creatures. I mean, imagine standing next to something like that in full gallop. The ground would literally shake, wouldn't it? In fact, one of the largest dinosaurs skeletons ever found was one they called Seismosaurus. Seismo meaning earth shaking. So literally they'd say the earth would shake when he ran along. And as I said, when we look at fossils, we can find lots of interesting things. Now we see, and I'm going to show you in the main service, that it actually requires rapid processes to get fossils, particularly when we see fossils like that. Because that guy's been fossilized in the process of eating his lunch. Now either he's a very, very slow eater and, you know, was digesting it over millions of years while he got fossilized, or something rapid had to happen to that fish while he was eating his lunch. Now, of course, here's a point. The reason they assign millions of years ages to fossils is because of where they find them in the rock record, in the strata. But I want you to think about this. If the fossils are formed quickly, regardless of their depth of burial, wouldn't it make sense that the rocks that buried them had to also be formed quickly? Whereas they say those layers slowly built up over millions of years. I'm going to talk more about where the idea of millions of years came from. So you'll see there's no problem with it. And we get incredible detail with fossils. Like that last one can obviously tell us a bit of a story. Okay? One minute he's eating his lunch, next minute he's buried under lots of mud and sediment and preserved for all time. Here we have a piece of dinosaur skin photographed by our staff geologist in Australia, Dr. Taz Walker. And you can see the creases and the bumps and the little nodules. It's so well preserved. See, how do you get that exquisite detail of preservation? Again, you've got to bury it quickly, like making almost a plaster cast of the fossil. And Australia is a kind of a very rich country in terms of the amount of dinosaur fossils that we have. Most of Australia is desert. It's a country as big as the United States, but we've only got 6 major capital cities in the whole country and about 22 million people. And most of it is desert, what you guys call the outback. And when we look in the outback, under that desert, we find lots of fossils, and they say, well, it looks like Australia was once underwater. Well, I agree. There's something in the Bible that tells us the whole earth was underwater at some stage. And we've got our own museum, specifically for dinosaurs, down in the nation's capital in Canberra. And these are some of the slides from the dinosaur exhibit at the National Museum. And this is how they're saying how fossils formed. Now remember, these events, according to their belief system, supposedly happened millions of years ago. Now, was anybody there millions of years ago to see these events? Of course not. So they say a dinosaur dies and he sinks to the bottom. Well, you're going to see there's the first mistake. You guys live near water. Do you see creatures and fish sink to the bottom when they die? What usually happens to them? They float. But apparently this dinosaur dies, sinks to the bottom. And then while he's lying on the bottom, look, he's preserved. How do you preserve a whole skeleton? I mean, where are the crabs and everything else that's chewing it apart? But it slowly gets covered. Now, we need to understand the idea of it being covered. It says that these sediments take millions and millions and millions of years to form. Slowly covers the dinosaur, lies there for millions of years, turns into stone, and then for some unknown reason, it gets uncovered. So there's a lot of appeals to unknowns there that people can't know if they weren't around 65 million years ago. And basically, that's the story on how we get fossils. But as I said, fossils can form rapidly, like this one. This is a fossilized hat. It was originally a leather hat. It was actually buried underwater in a mine in Tasmania. That's that little island that's off the south coast, which is actually a state. But the water was very heavily laden with minerals, and you can see it turned into a piece of solid rock in less than 50 years. Of course, the Bible tells us, doesn't it, that there was a global earth-covering catastrophe. It involved lots of mud, lots of water, lots of sediment. Mixing up the earth, you would have had lots of minerals in the ground. You have the great and perfect conditions for fossilization. And that's why we see lots of sedimentary layers laid down all over the earth. And in those layers, guess what we find? Fossils are a record of things buried. So again, you see, we have the same fossils, but we as creationists, as Christians, should interpret them a different way, understanding the world's history according to the Bible, that there was a global catastrophe. They say slow, gradual processes, millions of years. We say Noah's flood could have accounted for the majority of this stuff. And I'll talk more about that in the main service. There's lots of evidence that dinosaurs simply did not exist millions of years ago. Back in the late 90s, this was one of the first discoveries. Mary Schweitzer, a scientist from Montana State University, looked at a T-Rex leg bone, and under a microscope, she found this blood vessel, and those dots you're looking at there are actually unfossilized red blood cells. Now think about this. This is supposed to be at least the last dinosaur supposedly walked the earth 65 million years ago. Now let me just stop there, because even when I use the term millions of years, even to Christians, I think we've been so indoctrinated with that term, we don't stop to think about how long a period that is. So think that, boys and girls this morning, that's the grown-ups I mean, and the young ones, think about how old you are today. Think about how old you are. Now try to think about living to 100 years. Well, that's a pretty long time, isn't it? Now in terms of 100 years, okay, 10 times 100 is 1,000. Try to think about that in terms of your own lifespan. Try to think about what 100,000 years looks like. See, already the mind boggles, doesn't it? 1 million years? 65 million years? A billion years? And we hear scientists make claims as if somehow they can tell us exactly what happened or do tests to tell us what happened millions of years ago. You know, blood products degrade very, very quickly. Once death occurs, it degrades very quickly, particularly our DNA. Our DNA is repaired all the time by other repair systems in the cells. But what happens, we have these little letter mistakes, accumulations of mutations that are so small that they can't be seen, by the repair systems, and they accumulate. And once death occurs, DNA in particular breaks down very, very quickly. They not only have found blood products now, they found DNA in dinosaur bones. Okay? Well, look what the scientist said here. She said it was exactly like looking at a slice of modern bone. Of course, I couldn't believe it. I said to the lab technician, the bones, after all, are 65 million years old. How could blood cells survive that long? That's a really good question, isn't it? But notice the dogmatic statement she says. The bones, after all, are 65 million years old. Now, I don't have time to talk about it this morning, but I want to point out to you there's no radiometric dating test like carbon-14 or all those things you've heard of that you can use to prove the age of anything. They don't work like that. All you do is measure the amount of radioisotopes in your sample, but you don't know how much was in it when the creature died, to work it backwards like a clock. You don't know what the burial conditions were like. You don't know what the atmospheric conditions are like. There's no test you can use to prove that. The idea of millions of years, remember, comes from its position in the rock layer. But notice her belief is already that they are millions of years old, but she has evidence that they can't be millions of years old. So then they have to appeal to special conditions or special preservation conditions, etc. Now, what was interesting, that was the first discovery. Mary Schweitzer is an evolutionist. She got roundly criticized by her revolutionary colleagues for even presenting that information. Why? Well, because the creationists would be all over it, right? Now, that was the first. But you know what? There have been dozens and dozens and dozens of discoveries ever since because they're now looking for it. See, they never ever looked for it before. Why would you? The bones are millions of years old. Why would you look for these types of things? Have a look. This was reported in the prestigious Science magazine, a secular journal. You're looking at ligament, flesh, blood vessels, more red blood cells, she says, flexible and resilient when stretched to return to its original shape. Folks, does that sound like 65 million year old material to you? Of course not. What's the simplest answer? Can't be millions of years old. Here's Mary Schweitzer. She said, when you think about laws of chemistry and biology and everything else that we know say it should be gone, it should be degraded completely. So why isn't it? Well, if dinosaurs were made on day six of creation just a few thousand years ago, okay, then obviously they're not millions of years old. Have a look at this. This is one that was just on our website this month. In fact, I pulled this off last week just so I could show you folks. We're looking at a piece of skin, not fossilized. It's a piece of skin from a hadrosaur. And there's the scientist from Canada. He says, as we excavated the fossil, I realized this is not ordinary. This is real skin. Everyone involved with the excavation was incredibly excited. But it doesn't change their millions of years view. This is the point. The worldview, the paradigm is what remains. And I think dinosaurs are actually mentioned in the Bible, but not using the word dinosaur, right? Remember, it's a modern word. We see creatures like here, behemoth, another one called leviathan. They're left untranslated. And let's look at the passage here in Job 40, verses 15 to 18, and see if we can, you know, act as detectives a little bit and figure out what it might be. Well, the first clue, God's talking to the man Job. Now, Job, poor old Job's having a hard time, isn't he? God says, Job, look at behemoth, which I made along with you. Why was he diverting his attention to the behemoth? Well, this was something Job could wrap his mind around, couldn't he? This incredibly large creature, and God is kind of saying to him, look, I made him along with you. You think he's impressive, but Job, you're more important than him. I see you where you are. I see the problems that you're having. But the first clue is he eats grass like an ox. He's a vegetarian. Have a look at this. Strength in his loins, force in the muscles of his belly. Now, you know, I might be taking a long shot here, but I'm just wondering why God mentioned that. Well, maybe a clue is because if it's a sauropod dinosaur, sauropods are double-hipped. They're double-hipped. Our largest bones are our hip bones because they cradle our strongest muscles. And similarly with these sauropods, they have to hold up a huge long neck and a huge long tail. So literally their largest muscles are in their bellies, cradled by their hips. And then it says, you know, his bones are like tubes of bronze, like bars of iron. So it's obviously an impressive creature. But the real clue is this one. Have a look at this. He hangs his tail like a cedar. What are the cedars? Well, they're cedar trees, the cedars of Lebanon in the Middle East, where obviously Job would have lived. These are the same trees that Solomon built the temple out of. Here's a picture of one that was transplanted from the Middle East to Kew Gardens in London, the Botanical Gardens there, and you can see the girth of that tree. That's a pretty big tree, isn't it? Can you think of any land animal you know of today roaming around that has a tree like a cedar, a tail like a cedar tree? No, I think it only fits a sauropod dinosaur. Now, fortunately, my study Bible in the notes says it might be a hippo or an elephant. It shows you how even some of our theologians have been compromised in that respect. But have a look at this. There's the tail of a hippo. It's not exactly cedar tree-like, is it? All right. So we'll have a bit of fun here this morning. Boys and girls, I'll allow you to shout out in church, all right? But here's the tree-like tail. So you tell me yes or no whether you think it fits on this animal. We stick him on the back of an elephant here. Does that fit? No. What about if we put him on the back of the hippo there? What if we stick him on the back of this sauropod? See? See how we can think biblically, logically about these things, I believe? You know, there's lots of evidence, not just only unfossilized dinosaur skin and tissue and blood cells and DNA, which means they obviously died out very recently, but there's evidence that man saw them. This is a column in a doorway of the temple, the Angkor Wat temple in Cambodia in Southeast Asia. And we can recognize, obviously, some of the depictions there. Oops, let me go back one. Wrong button. You can see there's a person, there's an antelope or a deer. Down the bottom, there's an iguana. But look at that one. Any young boy or girl know what that is? Stegosaurus. Well done. There we go. There's an article on our site, Ankylosaurus stegosaur. And have a look. Even got the right number of bony plates, etc. We look here. This is a jade dragon, 4,000 years old. I'm going to show you in a moment. These come from a book that's outside. And what the author did, he actually just got an animator, an artist, and he said, look, I think that's a Protoceratops. You depict it. He didn't even instruct him. He said, you do your own research. I think it's a Protoceratops. You produce the detail. And you'll see that when he did, the detail is incredibly similar. Here's one here. This is a French tapestry from the 16th century. This is a Meiosaurus. Have a look. Look at the lobes where the ears are, the little recesses. The number of toes are exactly the same. Have a look. Incredible detail in the tapestries there. This book, Vance Nelson produced this, a friend of the ministry, spent hundreds of thousands of dollars. He fundraised of his own money touring all around the world to go into museums and cave paintings and whatever to find pictures where he believed people had seen dinosaurs. These are not isolated examples. They're all over the world, particularly in China. There's even pictures of Chinese emperors looking like they use these dinosaur-type creatures to pull their chariots. So it looks like even some of them were trained and even tamed. This one's interesting. Comes from our Creation magazine. Bishop Bell was an Anglican bishop buried in 1496 in Carlisle Cathedral in the north of England. And you can see around his tomb, there are these brass strips, and they were engraved. And we can look at the engravings now. You can see it's very dark. English CEO using a flash camera. You can see the flash marks because there was no natural light in the back of the church. But you can recognize those as a bat, fish, a dog, or a bird, right? And then have a look here. Looks like we've got the sauropod dinosaur Shunosaurus and the amphibious dinosaur Erops. Now, why do I think that's a Shunosaurus? Well, again, detail. Shunosaurus is the only one with the split tail and two spikes. So we've even got that sort of detail there on the engraving. He was buried, remember, 1496. A Mesopotamian cylinder seal. Have a look. Easily recognizable as Tanistrophius. He's the only one with a huge, long, spindly neck. And here we have Marco Polo, that famous explorer to the Far East. In his book, The Travels, he said, look, in this province live huge snakes and serpents of such size that no one could help being amazed even to hear of them. They are loathsome creatures to behold. They have enormous heads and eyes so bulging, they are bigger than loaves. Their mouth is big enough to swallow a man at one gulp. He goes on, their teeth are huge. All in all, the monsters of such inordinate bulk and ferocity that there is neither man or beast that goes in fear of them. They go to the dens where lions and bears and other beasts of prey have their cubs, gobble them up, parents as well as young. These are creatures that can gobble up adult bears and lions in a single gulp. Again, I can't think of anything on the earth today that would fit that description. Australia, well, if dinosaurs are only around even up to a few hundred years ago and we find lots of dinosaur fossils in Australia, it makes sense that perhaps Aboriginal people saw them. And they have lots of depictions. Here's just one. And we think this is a depiction of a plesiosaur. If you have a look, you can see the waves or the water depicted, fish, sea snakes. Look at the people, their legs apart, arms outstretched, obviously frantic, spears aiming at this creature. And of course, have you figured out why? Just eating one of their mates for lunch. Have a look at that. Every picture can tell a story, they say. So lots and lots of evidence. Now in the United Kingdom, in England, there's a famous knight called St. George. He killed a hissing dragon. The flag of Wales has a dragon on it. Why have I suddenly switched tack talking from dinosaurs to dragons? Well, remember the word dinosaur is a modern word? But in just about every tribe and people group over the world, around the world, they referred to these creatures and some of the depictions I showed you as dragons. That seems to be the word that was commonly used for them. So I simply think our legend of dragons are actually really our dinosaurs of history. So I've given you some clues. I hope you've been listening. Here's your first test this morning. Were dinosaurs on the ark? I gave you some clues that can help you answer the question. Don't think dinosaurs were on the ark? Some of you said yes, some of you said no. Well, here's the first clue. I've got a Polaroid photo of Noah trying to get Stegosaurus on the ark. Okay, if you've got these depictions at home, mums, dads, grandparents, of, you know, Noah's ark depicted like this, some leaky bathtub, I may suggest that you might want to get rid of them, because when you think about it, they're kind of representing Noah's flood and the ark as a fairy story, as a myth. The Bible spends a lot of chapters talking about the flood, and it even gives us details on the size of the ark, regardless of how long you think a cubit is. At the minimum, it's 462 feet long, 75 feet wide, 60 feet high. Noah only had to take on a maximum of 16,000 animals on the ark, and looking at the average size of creatures today, the Bible calls kinds, he could have fitted them all on one deck. Have a look at that semi-trailer and the people there for scale. There's a technical article on our site, peer-reviewed, Korean naval architects modeled it, showed that that shape would have been very, very stable in huge seas. Remember, it didn't have to sail anywhere. Okay, just had to float. God was obviously superintending the voyage. It had the carrying capacity of 522 railroad cars of stock. But you know, ladies and gentlemen, this is actually still not the biggest wooden ship in history. People, ancient people, had actually built even bigger ships than this out of wood. So the first clue I gave you, okay, remember the ark's plenty big enough, is some dinosaurs were as small as chickens. Okay, so in the average size of the dinosaurs, I said maybe something about the size of a small pony. But even with those huge, long dinosaurs that must have existed post-flood, why? Well, Job was being pointed and directed to one, so they survived the flood. That's how I know they must have been on the ark. But those large ones all came from an egg. Now, he didn't take eggs on board because Scripture's clear that he commanded the animals to walk to the ark. But Noah could have just taken young adults, teenage dinosaurs capable of reproducing after the flood, not fully grown. Okay, here's some more secular science to back up that theory. This is from Nature magazine, and you can see the growth rate of Apatosaurus here. This is looking at the fossil growth rings in their bones. You know how we look at tree rings, and in a year of good growth, the rings might be wide apart, and in poor growth or drought, they're narrow. Same with dinosaurs. And it looks like they undergo this teenage growth spurt. You can see from about age 5 up to about age 15, and then it levels out. So some of those dinosaurs that we saw that were really, really large were obviously very old dinosaurs. So Noah only had to take, as I say, teenage dinosaurs capable of reproducing after the flood. Your alligators and Australian crocodiles can reproduce at a young age. They don't have to be fully grown before they can reproduce. So remember I said that he only needed to take about 16,000 animals on the ark? See, he didn't need to take, you know, Chihuahuas and Great Danes and 300 breeds of dogs. He took a pair of dogs. And through something called natural selection, which is not evolution, boys and girls, be careful of this. At high school and when you get to college, teachers will say to you, change over time equals evolution. No. In the DNA of every living organism on this earth, God front-loaded it with enough information to allow them to survive and adapt in a post-fall, post-flood environment. Let me give you an example. You know, we have blind cave fish in Australia. Now, did they evolve blind eyes? No. In fact, the eyes, the loss of sight, means something is broken, a mutation. But actually being blind in a dark cave might be a survival advantage. So sighted fish die out and blind fish survive. And for evolution to occur, if you want to get from, you know, pond scum to people over millions of years, you've got to add lots of genetic information. Natural selection culls and reduces information, information that God already designed. So we have these modern varieties of creatures, and evolutionists might even call them species. Species is a man-made word as well. So we have zebras. Zebras are a type of horse. Tigers are a type of cat, for example. Goats and sheep will actually hybridize. It shows you they came from an original created kind. Camels and llamas will hybridize, believe it or not. But they've separated through natural selection. They can only change within preordained limits. So we actually don't know what the original kinds were like. Okay? But he didn't have to take lions and tigers on the ark. Have a look. There's a liger. Okay? It's called a liger because the male was a lion. Female was a tiger. If it was the other way around, it'd be called a tigon. Okay? Now, sometimes, yes, these are born fertile, but sometimes with hybridization, they're born infertile. Sometimes they are born fertile. And here's another interesting thing. When it comes to dinosaurs, Noah's job just got a lot easier because originally evolutionists came up with about 200 different species of dinosaurs. But remember, folks, we only find on most occasion fragments of fossils in the rock records. And when they're separated by several layers, they separate them by millions of years, and then they add lots of evolution and slow gradual change in there. Have a look at this. Here's three separate species of dinosaurs, Dracorex, Stegimoloch, and Pachycephalosaurus. But you know what? They actually know now they're actually the same species. They're one kind of dinosaur. But when they found their fossils, they found them at different stages in their growth. A bit like your deer here. You have antlers that might be, you know, different lengths and different sizes depending upon the age of it. If you remember the movie Jurassic Park, do you remember the lead character that was played by Sam Neill? That was based upon a real paleontologist, Mr. Dinosaur, Jack Horner. And it says here that Horner suggests that now one-third of all the named dinosaur species may have never existed, but are merely different stages in the growth of other known dinosaurs. So have a look. Here's now what they call the family of Ceratopsia. And the most famous of those, of course, is Triceratops. That was actually the first one they ever found. But look at all these. See how different they are? And of course, creatures change. I mean, human beings. Look at the variation just here within humankind, just sitting in church this morning. As I said, God allows that change, part of his design plan. And so these were all named separate species, but they are now just one distinct kind, as we creationists might say, of dinosaurs. And so we've gone from about 200 down to about 50 dinosaur kinds. So Noah now only has to take 100 dinosaurs aboard the ark, and they can reproduce and adapt after the flood. And you know, just about in every tribe and people group around the world, we have flood stories. In Australia, we have lots of different Aboriginal groups. They have different dialects and some even different languages. And they never had any written language. Everything was passed down orally or verbally, obviously, over the years. But here's one from some North American Indians. And they said, a powerful snake made all people wicked. The snake caused water to destroy everything. But on an island was a man named Manabozho, the grandfather of all men. He was saved by riding on the back of a great turtle. Obviously corrupted, isn't it, from the Bible's account of the flood. But you would expect that if things were not preserved or written down. Now, if we had a game of, I think you guys call it telephone, right? We can start at the front here. By the time I get to the back, a simple statement will change, even within a few minutes. So what's going to happen over hundreds and hundreds of years, of course? So here's the big question, right? Why don't we see dinosaurs today? Gary, if you say they even lived a few hundred years ago, why are they not around? Well, creationists believe that the one and only ice age occurred probably a few hundred years after the flood. By the way, a global flood is a great engine or mechanism for an ice age. It actually sets up the perfect conditions for a subsequent ice age. But creatures would have been going after unnatural prey. Now, you've heard about theories like the asteroid theory, right? Giant asteroid hit the Earth. Now, here's what's interesting. When you think about that and it threw lots of dust up in the atmosphere and killed off lots of creatures, why did it really only select dinosaurs? Why wasn't it a mass extinction event of everything else? Here are some other views that scientists have come up with. Now, they're funny, but they're actually real. Constipation theory, that obviously dinosaurs are not getting enough fiber in their diets, and of course, if you're over 50, you know what that problem's like. So there's a junkie theory, okay, that the plants evolved and became toxic, and obviously dinosaurs got addicted to them. And of course, if you like Gary Larson, there's his view of why dinosaurs became extinct. Now, of course, that one is not a real serious explanation, but the others are. And so why did I show you those? Well, we have a bit of a laugh, but it's telling us that they don't know. They come up with theories. They don't know what happened, why we don't see dinosaurs alive today. And another thing, ladies and gentlemen, the dinosaur fossils are not as common as you might think. In all the world's museums, there's probably less than 3,000 dinosaur skeletons in all the world's museums. Overwhelmingly, the majority of all the fossils, out of all the billions and billions of fossils we find, are creatures that typically live on the ocean floor. Algae, sponges. Vertebrate fossils account for probably less than 2% of the entire fossil record. Listen carefully. That's consistent with the global flood. Remember how we've had these tsunamis off the coast of Indonesia and Japan in the last few years? They're called subduction events, where the continental plates build up pressure and one plate subducts and sinks under the other. And when it does, it pulls down water. And then when that water is released, like a wave of energy, it rolls across oceans. Now, you could have been a boat. In fact, you go on YouTube and you can see the Japanese tsunami. There's a fishing boat on the water and they just go like that. But what's happening on the ocean floor? Well, a wave of silt like a hurricane is hurtling across the ocean floor. And then when the water shallows out, it reaches its destructive force and it enters the land. Now what happens is not necessarily going to bury things quickly on the land, but things are going to drown and they're going to float and bloat and get eaten by other predators, etc. So that's why I believe the evidence or the amount of, if you like, vertebrate fossils that we see is very rare. But if the overwhelming majority of those creatures that live on the ocean floor, guess what? That's consistent with the global breakup that was Noah's flood. And where you look at that geologic column, you know, where they have the simple and the complex at the top, that's not a record of evolutionary history. When you look at that column, as I said, 98% of that entire column are all creatures that live on the bottom. That it's not an equal distribution of the fossils. It's a record of the order of burial, actually, from Noah's flood. And Noah's flood lasted about a year. And when you look at that geologic column, they've got 2.5 billion years in there. Same evidence, the same facts interpreted differently. So as I said, I think we simply killed them out. You know, after the ice age, think about this. Creatures are going to move along the earth, spread out on the newly formed continents, but we've got to wait for plants and everything to regrow and trees. And so maybe even the dinosaurs went after unnatural prey and started eating people. But guess what? In harsh conditions, a nice triceratops like that, well, he's going to feed your family for a month, isn't he? And you don't particularly care if he's the last one. As I say, we weren't as environmentally conscious as we were back then. So what can we learn from today? Well, you know, when God was speaking to Job, as I said, he was having a hard time. And Job could look at that magnificent creature and think, wow, God made that. And yet God says, I'm more important than him. You know, one of the most amazing statements that Job made, you'll remember the passage when he says, I know that with my own eyes, my own flesh, I will stand upon the earth and my Redeemer lives. I will see him. He didn't have the benefit of seeing the incarnation. He hadn't seen Christ come in the flesh, but he believed God was creator. He believed if God could make magnificent creatures like this, he could raise him up from the ground. He could restore again. Why? Well, if he's the creator, he did it once, he could do it again. Of course, we know in the New Testament, in the book of Revelation, it says he is going to restore and recreate. But you know, when we look at the words of Jesus, in John 10:9, he says, I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. He will come in and go out and find pasture. You know, that's kind of a little bit analogous to what happened in Noah's time. See, figuratively speaking, if I can use this expression, you know, Jesus is like an ark of salvation in Noah's time, isn't he? God's going to save the world, those who believe in him. And in Noah's time, we read in Genesis 7:16, the animals were going in, male and female, of every living thing, as God had commanded Noah, and then the Lord shut him in. Did Noah pull the door shut? God shut the door. It's a very significant statement, isn't it? He's saying it's too late. Do you know creation scientists have estimated, we look at the age of the patriarchs, obviously they lived a lot longer, they've estimated that anywhere from 500,000 to up to 2 billion people could have been alive at the time of the flood. And so let me ask you this morning, how many of those people got on board the ark, or survived the flood, sorry, besides Noah and his family? How many? Besides Noah and his family. Anybody know? None. That's pretty sobering, isn't it? And think about this. You know, we can look in the Bible, we can estimate Noah took somewhere between 70 to 100 years to build this massive ship. He was building it on dry land. Think the neighbors would have been curious? Hey, Noah, what are you doing, mate? Well, I'm building this giant ship. God's going to destroy the world. Bah, humbug. No one believed. You know, I read scripture and it talks about the heart of God. It says he's not willing that any should perish. Do you think if anybody in Noah's time had said, can I come on board? I'm sorry, God. I repent. Do you think he would have let them on? Yeah, I think he would have. But doesn't it show you that people just ignored the warnings? In fact, they lived their lives as if God didn't exist. You know, that's actually what sin is. That's rebellion from God. And it tells us in the New Testament, 2 Peter 3:5, they deliberately forget. When's this talking about? It's talking about today. That long ago, by God's word, the heavens existed and the earth was formed out of water and by water. By the way, the origin of the universe was water, not a big bang. By these waters, also the world of that time was deluged and destroyed. They deliberately forget. There's evidence all around us. I could walk out here and dig down a couple of hundred feet. I would see evidence for the flood. And they ignore it. They assign millions of years of evolution, and it just writes God out of the picture. But we do that at our peril, because it was a sign of God's judgment. And the Lord Jesus reminds us again, he says, just as it happened in the days of Noah, so shall it be in the days of the Son of Man. They were eating, they were drinking, they were marrying, being given in marriage, living their lives as if God didn't exist, just like in Noah's time, until the day that Noah entered the ark and the flood came and destroyed them all. That's sobering, isn't it? Possibly 2 billion people destroyed. And yet he made a way for them to be saved. And the same magnificent creator made a way for us to be saved, didn't he? In fact, we don't have to go through all the effort of building an ark and collecting animals. All we have to do is believe in the one whom God sent and accept his free gift. See, the Bible's the history book of the universe. That's what I'm talking about today. It's not science. It's whether the Bible can be trusted. Can we really trust it from the very first verse? Because guess what? If I can't trust the book of Genesis, where does the truth begin in Scripture, ladies and gentlemen? Remember, lots of information. If you have questions, I'm going to be around for a few minutes before the service starts to answer your questions, but go to our website. Now, you're going to hear me talk a lot about information. Let me just share some of the books that we have out there. Now, again, I'm going to repeat this for the folks later. We don't even ask for a set speaking fee when we come to churches because we're supported to get information into your hands so that you can first equip yourselves and equip your children. That's vitally important. And we have all sorts of electronic ways that you can do it. We're on Facebook, Twitter. We've got a little media section on our site. You can get these little one-minute video clips to start a conversation with your friends. We've even got the QR code out there where you can scan it on your smartphones and download our app. I'll just go through. Oops, sorry, I'm not going to do this now. Issues if I don't have it up here. Oh, come on, Gary. Okay. We've got some packs of books out there. If you're interested in this, the Answers book is the 65 most asked questions on creation and evolution. It's a whole chapter, for example, on dinosaurs. I kind of say with the Answers book, every Christian home should have one. Whenever we have question and answer sessions, I always get questions that are in the Answers book, and that's why we call it the Answers book. Refuting evolution, if you've got children in college, junior college or high school, this deals with the stuff they will be taught about evolution. Okay, so again, immunizes them and equips them. You can buy those individually or in a pack out there. Homeschoolers, we've got a mega pack, you can save money. I mentioned the millions of years, and I'm going to show you in the next talk where the idea came from, so you don't really have to worry about trying to fit those millions of years in scripture. This book here, which is a children's book, actually it's an adult book in disguise, Exploring Geology with Mr. Hibb, is actually, would you believe, CMI's most popular selling book out of the hundreds and hundreds of resources we have. What it does, it teaches children how to interpret the geology around them from a real easy layperson's perspective. And it's got, have a look at it, lots of really colorful illustrations. The kids have just said, it's a lot of fun. That's the feedback we've had. There are hands-on activities. Parents, grandparents, take some time to actually just work through this with your children at home, because the biggest culprit for millions of years is geology. That's it. And if you can teach them how to interpret it biblically, they won't fall for the bait and switch. We've got a book out there, Dragons of the Deep, Ocean Monsters Past and Present, with lots of good biblical teaching along the way. Have a look at this. Again, it's about getting information out. This is 5 hardcover books for elementary age children and for less than $30. So it's about $6 or something each, which is incredibly cheap. The bottom 3 there are have actually parent helps at the back, some little notes so you can do a little bit of extra study by going to articles on our website. That one there, One Big Family, is a book that I co-wrote with my lovely wife who's here with me today, and it's the truth about where we all came from, this idea of races. Does the Bible use the term races, by the way? No, it's a man-made expression again. Bible says, of one blood, of one man, he made all nations of men. This subject is a real big one. When you talk to your friends, why does a good God allow death and suffering? That's my latest DVD. Just a few weeks ago, I got an email from a guy that does prison ministry, and he showed that, and he said the men were openly crying. 9 of them stayed behind, wanted to know more, and 3 of them gave their life to the Lord as a result of watching that DVD. So rather than avoid the subject, what I'm showing you is to look at the bad things that happen as a way of pointing people to the fact we live in a cursed and fallen world. There's that book, Man and Dinosaurs Living Together. Fran, is there any copies still out there? There's a couple of copies. A DVD, a 90-minute documentary, Dragons or Dinosaurs. This, as I say, it's been on TV, very interesting. If you're interested in natural selection and how creatures change, but it's not evolution, Dr. Don Batten, creatures do change, but it's not evolution. So we've got a bunch of DVDs out there. If any of you really want to get equipped some more, we have always have an offer. If you buy 4 of them, you can get a 5th one for free. And of course, my book, Alien Intrusion. I'll mention a little bit more about that in the second session, but that is a huge subject. Pastor's right. When scientists look at the complexity of DNA today and all that information, they think wise, intelligent aliens millions of years ago seeded life on Earth. So they'll believe anything except believing in God who's the creator, all right? So we're going to have a break now, and I'll be around outside if you've got any questions, and I'll see you later on. Thank you. Thank you.